I would like to try to inspire you a little bit and to share with you a story about a nation that succeeded to do what no other succeeded to do with regarding to our topic. The presentation should be on, is it? Knowledge economy, ICT ecosystem, ecosystem in general, are there a gift of God that given to some economies, or it is something that can be implemented? And if this is something that can be implemented, well, the question is, how do we unlock the secrets of the creation of those ecosystems? We don't have it yet. We will have it in a minute. And until that will be arranged, is it working or that we're going to do it without it? Try to arrange it, that will continue. This is the one, thank you very much. So, it's a story about a nation, the state of Israel, that just until lately had an economy that based on agricultural and traditional industry and an ecosystem that changed the face of the nation, changed the face of the industry, and succeeded to do what no other country succeeded to do until now. When we're talking about creation of ecosystem, we need to bear in mind that there are things in life you are doing in big steps. You do not try to cross a chasm in two steps. Gravity will make it fall and you will fall down. The same thing goes for creation of ecosystem, technology-oriented environment. You need to do one big step, not small incremental. It doesn't work. So this is, and in many of our conversation, in my conversation around the world with government, I'm accused by the fact that in Israel we've got everything. We've got venture capital, we've got entrepreneurs, we've got industries, we've got government support, we've got everything. This is the reason that this is the most, one of the most successful ecosystems around the world, especially for very tiny countries. Well, we didn't have that at the beginning, and we don't have it for the last 200 years. We had create that in less than two decades. This is the situation in mid-80s. Hyperinflation of more than 450% inflation rate, and this is the situation of Israel today. This is the map. Israel is the country with the largest number of multinational R&D centers located in the country, the largest per capita. And just try to imagine yourself the fact that this is kind of a hub for the entire world in enabling entrepreneurs in Israel to approach to any multinational company that they would like to do so, but do it in-house and not needed to fly far away. Israel considered to be the startup nation. It's just third after the state with number of companies listed on the Nasdaq. It's just second after the state with the amount of money managed by venture capital. It's first in startup per capita and it's first in multinational R&D per capita. And this is not front office of selling licenses. This is R&D. This is where the solution that this industry, the ICT industry, is implemented all around the world. And there are a lot of success stories all the time. This is just a small list of exits. And you can see that there are exits in tens of millions, hundreds of millions, and billions. And that's the meaning of knowledge economy. You are taking the knowledge, you are packaging the knowledge, developing the knowledge, and sell it. The total amount of exits in 2015, crossed $9 billion. This is cash in to the state of Israel, to entrepreneurs. This is covering deals of companies that have been sold. Mid-2016, Israeli company raised more than $2.8 billion. Just the first half. Israel is leading and has led until just lately, until last year, the index of civil R&D as a percentage of the GDP. Last year, Korea took the honorable first place. The meaning of that index is very simple. This is the working capital of the industry. That was more than $12 billion. Working capital. This is where you're paying salaries, by machineries, by raw material, paying for services. This is expenditures. This is not investment. This is not fundraising. And the interesting things about this number is that by no comparable to no any other countries, 85% of that expenditures coming from the private sector, and only 15 coming from the private, from the public. The second most interesting things about this figure is that 50% of the resources, the money, is not even Israeli money. It's foreign funds that coming to invest in Israel. But there are problems. Not everything is going smoothly as it's look like. And Israel got a problems. It's an isolated country. Leave politics aside, we cannot trade with our neighbors. And and we are very far for our end potential market, Europe, the States, Asia, Latin America. Therefore, Israeli entrepreneurs developed a strategy that going globally from day one. And the meaning of that strategy is that companies in their DNA are creating to be global. Let me show you one thing. When you're creating a company to be global, by fact, you will serve the local market. It's guaranteed. But it doesn't work the other way around. If you're creating a local company, to go into the next stage of being global, it's a lot harder. It's been said yesterday by Dr. Herself about the topics of failure. In the Israeli culture, it is not that we are just accepting failures. It is more than that. We are embracing failures. Failure considered to be an asset. I've recruited a lot of CEO to a lot of my portfolio companies. I would never recruit a CEO that at least did not fail once in his life. Is that unique to Israel? Is Israel the only nation, small nation, that succeeded to achieve those significant achievements? Well, the answer is no. Some call them the small G6. New Zealand, Ireland, Finland, Singapore, Israel, and Denmark. Each one of those countries succeed to achieve and to build a very successful, innovative environment for ICT and for other sectors. Each one of those countries has achieved to do so in its own way. And that takes us to the question of this panel. Can this success story be duplicated? I will leave that slide as a background, and I will go without further ado to my panel member. Lisandro, you have a connection in the VC, in the Silicon Valley, and all across Latin America. You have witnessed a lot of uneven entrepreneurial management capabilities can be crossed and could be managed Latin America and around the world. How can these gaps in knowledge, management capabilities could be bridged? How can this necessary skill be built up in a short period of time, because we both know that creating a critical mass in a short period of time is mandatory.
Thank you, Aaron, for your always inspiring introduction, presenting the Israeli case to inspire us. And thank you to this audience, and I'm amazed to know that not only the people that are here, but 30,000 people or more are following these presentations through social media and Facebook. And that's really amazing for me and compelling. So the agenda that you have proposed on how to address the issue of entrepreneurial management skills gap and the knowledge skills gap, how to solve it, I always try to separate the presentation in three topics, so what to do, how, and who. What to do is a vision, how is a strategy on how to do it. These two things are necessary conditions, but until the moment when you don't have people in action, things do not occur. And to start up, I would say that in order to bridge this gap, and my perspective is the perspective of a venture capital investing in early stage technologies in Latin America during the last 15 years, have invested in Mercado Libre, in Despegar, more recently in companies that are also operating in Brazil, in software for banks, in social media. But overall, there is a strong correlation, and you have a chart shown there on the influence of science, technology, innovation, investments as a percentage of GDP. Latin America is investing overall less than 1% of GDP in science, technology, innovation, venture capital. A country that really has a strategy, I would say, thinks that investing 3% of GDP is like a basic baseline to try to bridge the gap. So although many things have been done in Latin America to increase the entrepreneurial drive, the innovation, venture capital-backed companies, anyway, my perception is that unless public-private partnerships invest more in science, technology, innovation, and venture capital, the gap will widen, will not be diminished. And Israel invests 4.5% of GDP in private sector innovation. So, of course, this is a very high standard, but if a message comes from my presentation today to private public is to get an agreement on vision and strategy to increase significantly science, technology, innovation, and venture capital in our region. The second thing on how to do it, the what and how, is in my own experience, venture capital is about investing in value propositions, in business plans, but in teams. Basically, I always choose a team. And a team that from the very beginning thinks global, thinks big. I used to tease now my US friends, telling them, the problem you have in the US is that you are small. You are only 250 million people. Believe me, the companies that will be in the top 100 companies in the world in the next 20 years are the companies that are addressing issues for solving not 250 million people issues or problems or diseases or whatever, are companies that are thinking in terms of a billion people, even 2 billion people. These are the companies that are going to be big, and this is the opportunity for emerging markets, and Latin America among them, to address the issues of the billion people with digital and innovation technologies. In my own experience, to create teams that really think globally from the very beginning implies to blend and to merge these teams from the very beginning with advisors, with team members, that belong to the hubs where innovation really is leading the world. And this is very concentrated. The Israeli people, nobody in Israel thinks of innovating something without thinking going to the US market. The sooner, the better. We know that 50% of venture capital invested in US is Silicon Valley. 10% is Boston, 10% is New York. Israel really is a significant player within this map. And I would say that following your presentation, I loved Latin America to be part of the G6 that you have mentioned. We are in the middle. We are much smaller than China. We are much smaller than India. All Latin America is 600 million people. So perhaps our aspiration is to merge with people that so far we have not connected, but have implemented successful replications of the innovation US model originally. And Latin America, it's the problem we have is that from a top-down perspective, the world sees, well, US, Europe, China, India, Latin America. Latin America comes fifth because we are only 600 million people. But overall, also, Latin America, although geographically is a region, from the point of view of economic and even culture, with the exception of language, we are very diversified economies and culture. Top down, Latin America is Brazil, a little bit less than 50% of the Latin American economy. When I used to go to fundraise to the US and say, I come from Latin America, Brazil was the answer. Till 2 years ago, 90% of all the money coming to venture capital in Latin America thought about Brazil. Mexico is a little bit more than 20%, and after that you have Argentina and Colombia, two together, a little bit more than 20%. These are the four leading economies of Latin America. If you think of Latin America, you can also think in terms of Pacific Alliance, which is Mexico, Colombia, Peru, and Chile, that have a very structured system of integration through free trade with the US. And we are the Mercosur. From Argentina, we never think about going to the world without having a stopover and a joint venture with the Brazilians. For us, Brazil is the big market. But the problem with the Brazilians is that, in my experience, they tend to think more domestically. They don't tend to think globally. So my message for you Brazilians is you have to start to think and act globally if you want to really be a leading player in the world as you propose yourself to be, because you have a consistent vision of Brazil being big, not only in soccer, but also in the economy. And this is a culture issue. When we wanted, I always remember and refer the case when we wanted to enter with Technisys, a software company for banks that is doing Banco Original here in Brazil, and as a partner with a VC fund that was working also in Brazil, he says to me, and he's a very distinguished and delightful colleague, but Lisandro, I'm in São Paulo, you know. For me, going to Rio is really an effort. So my judgment is that if Brazil doesn't change its attitude of integrating into the world with a global perspective, you will not restructure the economy in a competitive world way, especially after the moment when US has integrated with China and the smartphone is designed in California and manufacturing in Asia. So this value chain has been completely changed in the last 20 years, and we from Mercosur have to address this issue in a creative and positive way if we don't want to lose the track. So Brazil has the market, internal, but very inward-looking. Chile is interesting, because Chile, if you do top-down, all the money goes to Chile, because they have the institutions, the stability, the rule of law. The problem is that they don't have the entrepreneurs. So Chile has been very proactively importing entrepreneurs. Mexico is something strange because they are already very, they don't like to see it this way, but Mexicans are very integrated to the US economy, And if you take manufacturing, especially, they are absorbing innovation through, and the automotive industry is a case, but really integrated with the value chain of the US. In Argentina, we do have the entrepreneurs. Of the 5 unicorns of Latin America, we have 4. We have the only 2 companies listed in technology in New York Stock Exchange and NASDAQ, Mercado Libre and Globant. And so the innovation is there, the creativity is there, the entrepreneurship is there. We didn't have the institutions. We didn't have the rule of law. So what's the message if we want to bridge the gap? For Brazil, think global, act global. For Mexico, just go to the US, you have all the windows open there easily. For Chile and Peru, I see them specializing in innovation in their natural resources production. I see Chile being very interesting in creating, in digitalizing mining. So creating many solutions for the mining industry global based on their natural resources. And for Argentina, the challenge is very simple. We have to build trust in our country, just respecting the law. And if you go from the macro to the micro, what do I do to bridge the gap? I can tell you 2 examples that reflect this attitude of thinking global and acting global. Short. I knew this guy through LinkedIn because Suncor Insurance Company wanted to put $20 million in innovation in Argentina, in very disruptive innovation. I told them, well, listen, nobody has this experience in Argentina. So talent is not a commodity, but talent is tradable and can flow. So bringing best experience from Silicon Valley or from Israel for leading hubs of innovation to our region, I think is the key success factor to bridge the law. And last but not least, when the who is not only private sector, is not only public sector, the challenge for us, I think, in our region is to really have public-private partnership working towards developing the innovation economy based on entrepreneurial talent. We need to align this best. There are good examples in the world on how to do it, and I hope that that will be achieved in the next 10 years.
Thank you, Alessandro. Thank you very much. Eric, as an active investor in Latin America for more than a decade, what happened to innovation ecosystem without the critical mass, and how can critical mass can be created? And Brazil is an amazing example for that.
Sure. I'm totally kind of first of all aligned with Lisandro's ideas here. I think, you know, there's a huge potential to be unlocked. I've been investing in venture capital in Brazil and the region through our fund, Monashis Capital, in the last 10 years. What I can say is that there has been a lot of progress, even though with all the roller coaster kind of turbulence that we see in the last 10 years, there has been progress. When we started, and I think there's something that, of course, is linked to what's happening in the world. There's an entrepreneurial revolution. There's a technological revolution that is clear, that is happening in the world. 10 years ago when we started, I was seeing that the other day and I was surprised. 10 years ago, the 5 largest companies in the US were Exxon, GM, Walmart, Ford, and Chevron. And today, the 5 largest companies are Apple, Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and Amazon. So that tells you something. And I'm really positive that that's going to happen in the region too in the next decades. It's just that the last 10 years, I mean, we're starting from almost zero in the ecosystem to what we have today. And as you know, in exponential curves, you know, in the beginning, it looks like it's not moving, but it's actually moving in a really fast way. And I think we are approaching an inflection point. The quality of entrepreneurs, the awareness about this digital revolution, what's happening in the world again that's changing the game is that technology, and I'm talking about digital technology, I think biotechnology or energy, it have different dynamics, so like to focus on digital, which is something that, we are, that we do, and you know, and it's the theme of this this conference. But in digital, what happened in the last few years is that technology was something more distant from the consumers, from the users, and today it's part of our lives. It's an inherent part of our lives, and also technology was something that had a high cost, a high entry cost, and today is very, very low cost. So a team in a garage can build an app and reach the global market. So it's accessible. So it's reaching everybody, and it's not different in Brazil. The point is about innovation. We're talking about innovation. I think early in the formation of the ecosystem, we cannot just really demand or say, okay, we're going to just go from zero to a highly innovative ecosystem in like 2 or 3 years. It takes time. Looking at the development of the ecosystems around the world, and I think we have three examples. Silicon Valley, of course, is the really, really, you know, the mecca of innovation in digital. But when you look at what happened in China and Israel, we see that these ecosystems, they have some similarities, but they actually evolved in different ways. They happen, you know, in with different vocations of each region. And I think it's not going to be different in Latin America. We have to look at our vocations. We have to look what we're good at and enhance that. When I look at Brazil, for example, you know, when we say about talk about global innovation, we say, oh, it's, you know, it doesn't happen there. And of course, there's the number of patents and the number of engineers. It's hard. We have to get there. But we have world-class innovation institutions. Look at Embraer that competes, you know, in the very sophisticated aeronautics industry. Look at the INPA, the Institute for Applied Mathematics in Rio, that actually we won a Fields Medal, which is the equivalent of a Nobel Prize in mathematics a couple of years ago. Look at agribusiness. I think both Brazil and Argentina have very sophisticated, you know, agribusiness kind of technologies. And so all these things show that we have examples. It's not that we're starting from zero. We just have to channel it. And in my opinion, channeling the resources, we're talking about basically talent and capital. These are the two things that we have to just unlock. It's not easy. In terms of talent, it's a combination of education, so we have to improve our policies and our efforts on education, just make it more efficient, take a little bit of risk in moving to the revolution in education that also technology is bringing, you know, and not the industrial revolution education model that we live in. So we have to, and we have an opportunity to leapfrog. A couple of decades ago, it would take 2 generations, 3 generations to change education. Now with technology, we have a chance of changing it faster. So we have to change education. The good thing is that I believe that Brazil has the most difficult, and Latin America in general, has the most difficult part, which is creativity. I think we are known as a creative, you know, region and people. We mostly apply this creativity to arts, to music, to day-to-day things, but not in innovation. And in my opinion, it's because we don't have the other part, which I think it's the easiest part, which is planning. Because creativity without planning is improvisation. Creativity with planning is innovation. And we're not good at planning. And it's not that hard to develop planning. We're not good at planning because everything is so difficult that, you know, long term is like 6 months for us. We have to start looking more in the long term and start to plan, to practice planning. And I think together with education, we can get there. We also need to bring talent from abroad, which can cut a little bit, you know, create some shortcuts. So creating, you know, some kind of incentives to and facilities to bring kind of really talented people from abroad. I mean, I really believe that in the future, countries will compete for talent. They are already competing for talent, and this competition is going to be stronger. On the capital side, it's not about, in my opinion, just government giving out money for startups. It's not about creating this financial incentive. In my opinion, it's about removing the obstacles. When you remove the obstacles and let the free markets flow and the human nature of the entrepreneurial nature of the region flow, something magic happens, and it will attract more local capital, and it will attract more international capital. And that's how I believe will happen. What we see is that, and it's clear, the interest of corporations on getting closer to startups. Disruptive innovation, just to finalize, disruptive innovation is coming more and more and will come more and more from startups. Incremental innovation will come from corporations. Disruptive innovation from startups. It's not going to come from academics, world, or the government. Practical innovation, disruptive, is going to come from startups. Just look at Uber, you know, in 5-6 years, what's making to urban mobility. Or Oculus Rift that was acquired by Facebook in virtual reality. Or a company we were talking about in Argentina called Blue Smart, which is revolutionizing luggage, you know, with smart luggage approach that you can have a GPS tracker or USB kind of ports to charge your batteries and you can weight itself. Things that there are some examples of startups that are creating disruptive innovation that can be global in the region. So the process is happening. It's not that visible yet. It's going in the right direction. What we need is to let it, you know, just remove the obstacles to let it happen faster.
Thank you, Eric. Sebastián, what role does public-private partnerships play in creating sustained innovation ecosystem? And what hold back the public sector in Brazil from launching those initiatives to success?
Bom dia a todos. Primeiramente, queria agradecer o convite, a oportunidade de estar aqui nesse evento tão relevante, nessa área de inovação, tecnologia da informação e comunicação. Queria falar um pouco, rapidamente, sobre o CPQD. O CPQD completou 40 anos inovando nessa área da tecnologia da informação e comunicação. Já estamos há 40 anos em nosso país provendo soluções nessa área de TIC. E aqui vou poder contar um pouco da história da inovação em nosso país, falar um pouco das parcerias públicas e privadas que nós temos e também tentar relacionar aí com essa história de Israel, uma história bonita, um país hoje altamente desenvolvido, um país que investe forte nessa área de tecnologia de informação e já usufrui de muitos resultados. É um dos países mais avançados aí do mundo e um dos países que mais gera patentes e tecnologias para o mundo. Quando a gente fala em parceria público-privada, o CPQD, há um bom período, já vem usufruindo dessa parceria público-privada com o governo federal. Em 1998, quando nós fomos privatizados, nós éramos um centro de pesquisa e desenvolvimento da Telebrás, na época, sistema monopólio no setor de telecomunicações. De 98 para cá, nós temos um parceiro muito forte com o governo, através do recurso do Funtel, é um fundo nacional de fomento à tecnologia em telecomunicações. De lá para cá, o CPQD ele vem, com essa parceria, desenvolvendo muitas soluções nessa área de TIC e trazendo valor para o nosso país. De lá para cá, o CPQD, através de suas inovações, ele criou três empresas. A Paditec, uma empresa de equipamentos de sistemas óticos. A Trópico, um equipamento de centrais digitais. E, recentemente, a Brasil Photonics, uma empresa de dispositivos óticos. Então, com essa parceria, nós estamos trazendo para o nosso país cada vez mais riqueza. Hoje, nossa missão é trazer o desenvolvimento, o progresso e o bem-estar à nossa sociedade nessa área de TIC. Então, hoje, com os nossos desenvolvimentos, nós estamos gerando para o nosso país uma média de R$1 bilhão ano com essas tecnologias, seja através do CPQD, seja através das nossas empresas. Recentemente, a gente vê no nosso governo federal várias iniciativas relacionadas com a parceria público-privada. Uma delas que eu posso citar aqui é a Embrapi. Em 2013, o governo federal lançou A Embrapic é uma empresa brasileira de inovação industrial. A Embrapic ela tem uma relação forte com o Ministério da Ciência, Tecnologia, Inovações e Comunicações e com o Ministério da Educação. A Embrapic ela veio justamente para tentar corrigir no passado algumas distorções voltadas a fomento nessa área da inovação e tecnologia da informação e comunicação. Ela desburocratizou aquele processo de quando você estruturava uma parceria entre uma ICT, entre uma indústria, na hora de você elaborar o contrato e o projeto, tinha uma burocracia muito grande, onde demorava meses para você concretizar essa parceria. Hoje, não mais que dois meses, nós temos a concretização desse contrato entre uma ICT e uma empresa. E esse recurso, uma parte vem do governo, um terço vem da indústria e outro terço vem da ICT. É um recurso não reembolsável, então é um recurso que ele proporciona às empresas participantes desse consórcio uma mitigação do risco. A gente sabe que todo o processo de desenvolvimento ele tem um grau de risco, e esse risco ele é mitigado com essa parceria. Então, de 2013 para cá, a gente já pode ver muitos resultados dessa parceria público-privada através da Embrapi. Nós participamos desse processo, outras instituições participam. Agora, o que nós estamos precisando para que esse programa venha cada vez mais a ter sucesso é um investimento maior das empresas. Estou falando isso em nível de Brasil. Nós sabemos que o país está passando por um momento de transição, um momento de alto desafio, e as empresas elas estão sem capital para reinvestir. Então, a gente sabe que hoje há uma insegurança muito grande no investimento voltado à inovação, porque sempre tem um risco. Então, para que a gente possa dar continuidade a esse programa possa ter cada vez mais sucesso, há necessidade de cada vez uma participação maior das empresas e um investimento maior das empresas. Diferentemente de Israel, que nós acabamos de ver aqui pelo nosso moderador, que lá ao contrário, as empresas investem mais e o governo investe com uma parte menor. Aqui não, aqui a gente ainda tem uma equalidade no investimento. O governo ele entra com um recurso expressivo nesse investimento. Então, eu diria que nós poderíamos ter uma chance muito grande através desses programas da Embrapi, como tem outros programas. A própria FINEP, né, que é uma financiadora de projetos de inovação e pesquisa, ela também tem os seus programas dentro dessa parceria público-privada, onde ela provê recursos não reembolsáveis através de alguns programas. Então, eu diria que...
Sebastião, the conclusion.
Eu vou concluir. Então, eu diria que nós temos vários programas no país dentro desse processo da parceria público-privada. Nós precisamos é dar continuidade, nós precisamos participar mais desses programas. Obrigado.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Francisco, we have talked about that on the break before we get into this panel. And you had an amazing example. What are the elements holding back Brazilian innovation, and how could the lessons of Brazil innovation ecosystem apply to develop ecosystem around the world or in Latin America?
Bom dia. Na verdade, eu planejei para falar 10 minutos. Aí o contexto mudou e o Eric fala que a gente não tem planejamento, mas aqui eu só posso falar 5. Então, eu vou fazer uma apresentação bastante sucinta do que a ABS. É uma associação que fez 30 anos e o nosso lema é conectar, proteger, orientar, desenvolver. Eu vou ter que passar rápido isso aqui. Nós temos uma ideia bastante capilarizada do Brasil, que nós temos 1.600 associados, dos quais 86 são micros e pequenas empresas que tiveram no passado 60 bilhões de reais de faturamento e 120 mil empregos diretos. A ABS tem uma série de facilidades para os associados, que eu vou pular porque não vale a pena perder tempo com isso. Nós temos parcerias aí sim interessantes com vários centros tecnológicos no Brasil, todos trabalhando em pesquisa e empreendedorismo. E eu peguei aqui um slide de tudo que se fala aí sobre empreendedorismo, começar desde a sua ideia. O crítico no Brasil está ainda em levantamento de fundos, levantamento de capital, que é uma coisa crítica no Brasil por várias razões. E pensei o seguinte, como é que o empreendedor vê o mundo? Ele vê um pouco diferente da gente, o empreendedor. Tem uma frase do Nizam Guanais que eu não me senti seguro de traduzir para o inglês, mas é que tudo que fica pronto na vida foi construído antes na alma, na mente da gente e depois foi feito. Então o empreendedor vê tudo diferente, ele vê desconecte, desconexão, desproteger, disruptura, invenção, e é um pouco difícil, talvez a ABS tenha que mudar o seu lema nos próximos anos. O empreendedor vê um mundo bastante diferente, o MacArthur, um australiano, que resolveu que as convenções para ele não se aplicavam e fez um mundo diferente, uma visão diferente do mundo que um empreendedor precisa. Agora, eu vou falar um pouquinho sobre o mercado brasileiro de TI e de software. São as startups de ontem que deram certo hoje. E os números são parecidos com o Lisandro falou. Estados Unidos, não precisa nem dizer, é o número um em investimentos em TI, seguidos pela China, e o Brasil está em sétimo lugar, com 60 bilhões de investimentos em TI. O Brasil conseguiu crescer o ano passado na área de software, de TI, ainda 9%, a despeito dos problemas na economia brasileira, que foi uma descida, e a gente conseguiu crescer nesse ramo, 9% do crescimento. Na América Latina, o Brasil é 45% do investimento em TI, com 60 bilhões de dólares, seguido pelo México, com 26,8. Eu queria fazer um comentário aqui. O Brasil exportou 8%. Desses 60 bilhões de dólares, exportamos 1,2%. O México exportou 20%, 5,2 bilhões de dólares. O México pensa no mercado americano, não chega ao ponto de Israel, que pensa no mercado global, mas ele já pensa para fora. Colômbia e Argentina, parecidos, com 10 bilhões cada um. E o Chile também, que também pensa para fora, globalmente. Eu não vou entrar nesse detalhe dos 60 bilhões. Só em software e serviços, nós estamos em oitavo lugar, com 27 bilhões de dólares. E o investimento total no mundo chegou a 3,7 bilhões de dólares. O Brasil está em sexto lugar.
Francisco, the conclusion of those data about on the influence of the creation of LC ecosystems.
A ABS tem proposta para o ramo de inovação e fomento, e a gente tem 10 propostas que basicamente são os seguintes: são aumentar os fundos para os recursos iniciais para desenvolver uma startup, uma inovação, achar uma maneira de facilitar os empréstimos sem garantias colaterais, que hoje os bancos de fomento pedem garantias colaterais que as startups não têm. São as garantias reais. Temos que discutir temas de interesse, nós estamos fazendo isso, mas o que eu acho crítico aqui é o quarto item, que é de políticas públicas, que elas têm que ser de longo prazo, têm que ser previsíveis, têm que ser claras, simples, transparentes e objetivas. E elas não foram mantidas assim esses últimos anos. E uma coisa importante também é os programas de fomento, que é o item 9, que eles têm que ser de longa duração. Ficar mudando o nome do programa e fazer um manual de 200 páginas para o empreendedor tomar conhecimento como pegar o dinheiro, complica muito o negócio. Então, o ideal seria que os bancos de fomento brasileiros, BNDES, FINEP, tivessem programas que durassem com o mesmo nome, com as mesmas qualidades, as mesmas necessidades por muito tempo, entendeu? Então, basicamente é isso. E essa apresentação está disponível no site da ABES. Os dados sobre o Brasil também estão disponíveis no site da ABES. E do Brasil e do mundo. Queria agradecer o Warren e, em particular, o pessoal da CESPRO, que teve a coragem de trazer esse evento para a América Latina pela primeira vez.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Joe, last but not least, and with a bit of limitation of time, you have wrote books and you're expert on corporate innovation. Two very direct questions. What are the rules of corporation innovation in an LC ecosystem, and how can cooperation contribute to the innovation ecosystem?
So there's 45 seconds left on the clock, which includes the 2-minute wrap up.
We've got 5-6 minutes.
Okay, so I'll be brief. So the first comment I would make is, innovation is so nuanced and variable that it's hard to generate simple rules that always apply that are guaranteed to generate innovation. And so, just as an example, the whole discussion about public-private partnerships seems very plausible. And if you look at various places in the world, including in the US, there have been successful examples of that. Maybe the best example would be NASA with the space program in the 60s that sort of defined the notion of moonshot. But, interestingly enough, and to be a little controversial so that the panel just doesn't always agree with each other here, if you look at, as Eric mentioned, the current 5 largest capitalized companies are all digital in some way or another. So Apple, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, and Amazon. And if you look at their history, there was no public-private partnership that led to their creation. Facebook started as a, fun late-night project in a dorm room at Harvard. Amazon was a guy that drove across country in a station wagon with an idea to sell books on the web. Google was the back rub research project to index the web and help do search. And it was two guys in a dorm room, Sergey and Larry. Microsoft was one guy that happened to negotiate the rights to DOS very effectively. And Apple was two guys in a garage. So there was no public-private partnership. So what was there? There was a fertile environment that may be hard to replicate in some cases, which includes venture capital. It includes diverse collaboration, because the US has been traditionally very friendly to immigration. And so a number of those entrepreneurs came from abroad. And so it's a mix of that culture around willingness to take risks and risk-taking and failure being viewed not as a disaster, but a failure being just moving you one step closer to ultimate success. You know, and you've got angel investors and you've got the university structure. So all those things together are, you know, also arguably a path to support innovation. Now, within corporations, corporations traditionally have a very difficult time of innovating. I'm going to cover this a little bit more in my keynote this afternoon, but briefly, one of the interesting things has been the evolution of innovation from the solitary inventor, whether it's an Archimedes or a Mark Zuckerberg, to what was called shop invention, like a Thomas Alva Edison in the Menlo Park labs, to the first early corporate research labs like GE, which back over a century ago created the first corporate research lab, through what's been called the spirit of open innovation. And the idea there is that corporate innovation can be enabled or enhanced by working outside the boundaries of the corporation. So the classic example is Procter & Gamble, which realized that they had 8,500 scientists and researchers in relevant disciplines within the company, but there were 1.5 million such researchers and scientists outside of the company. So it's a simple numbers game. You want to go outside the company. But briefly now, I think that open innovation, as originally structured by Henry Chesbrough in his early 2000s book called Open Innovation, is giving way to a new type of innovation, which I call accelerated innovation. And the basic difference is that the strategy for open innovation that he argues for is one that is relatively static. I'm a company, I have an idea, I don't know how to bring it to market, so I pick a distribution partner. Or conversely, I've got strong distribution capabilities, but I don't have all the ideas that I would like, and so I, you know, structure some partnerships with, let's say, a particular research university that has capabilities within a field of interest. I work with them on ideas, or maybe through a joint venture with another company. But now we have much more ad hoc capabilities that ultimately are enabled by the infrastructure that is global that exists. So actually, you know, anyone, anywhere can be an entrepreneur, leverage a global platform called the internet and app stores to be able to reach a broad audience. Now, that said, there are obviously advantages to localization. So, you know, if you're Chinese language or Portuguese language and you can do something that is culturally relevant, then that can be a secret to bootstrapping yourself up to something that ultimately turns out. So I could go on, but I know we're out of time, so I'll just say that, you know, there are many different strategies, and I think because there are so many elements that include funding, that include some overall vision and areas of concentration, that include local cultural attributes, universities, entrepreneurs, education, you've got to kind of bring all that together and then create a virtuous cycle. But these days, with digital being an industry in and of itself and being key to virtually every other industry, we really are entering a period of innovation like we've never seen before.
Thank you very much, Joe. With the limit of time, Eric, one sentence, one thing that a nation, an industry, should do in order to develop the ecosystem, either locally or globally, whatever environment that you find, one sentence that will be measurable KPIs that even WITSA could next year see if this idea was adopted or implemented. One thing, one sentence that should be done in order to further develop the ecosystem in Brazil.
Well, talking about Brazil, maybe I'm repeating something I said before, but I think the government should really focus on removing obstacles, which means eliminating bureaucracy, simplifying tax rules, simplifying labor laws. Eliminating the obstacles should be the focus. Everything will happen almost by magic if they do that. And in terms of KPI, I think it's number of days to open a company, for example, would be one.
Thank you. Lisandro.
Five total. And you only have to introduce four. evil German.
If I have to choose one metric, I would say to all the governments of Latin America, evil? Take the ranking of doing business of the World Bank. Brazil ranks, I think, 130, Argentina 120. The best position country in Latin America is Chile, 45. So we want to play the game of really being very vibrant, competitive, innovation economies in the world. We have to position Latin America in the top 10% of this ranking. And this implies 150 different, very simple things that you have to simplify to unlock talent and bring capital for innovation.
Thank you. Sebastião.
Eu vou juntar os meus colegas e vou reforçar que, sim, temos que tirar as restrições, melhorar essa burocracia, essa parte de patentes que não foi comentado, nós precisamos melhorar as avaliações da patente, hoje 10 anos para a gente ter a liberação da patente, e mais, que a iniciativa privada realmente cada vez mais possa estar se juntando ao governo e assim buscando mais investimento. Nós estamos falando de sair de 1% para 2% ou 3% do nosso PIB, para que a gente possa cada vez mais trazer riqueza para o nosso país.
Francisco.
Oren, acho que é o seguinte, precisamos no Brasil aumentar a segurança jurídica. No Brasil é mais fácil prever o futuro do que prever o passado. O passado é um fantasma que te atormenta em qualquer empresa e sempre tem alguma coisa do passado que vai te perturbar. Isso mostra a falta de segurança jurídica do país. É só isso.
Joe.
So, as far as what the country can do, I would just emphasize what Eric said and several others, but even more so, which is, it isn't just a matter of removing barriers because countries are competing with each other for intellectual capital and investment and a skilled workforce. And so you've actually got to do better. So, you know, a lower tax rate than anywhere else and more incentives for education than anywhere else because you're trying to sort of right an imbalance. As far as what corporations can do and a specific metric around that, it just amazes me no end that companies rely so heavily on internal R&D instead of going outside through these things like innovation networks and idea markets and contests and challenges. So a very simple metric that a corporation can measure itself by and can be done aggregately by WITSA is the percentage of revenues that come from innovations that were acquired from outside the company, or at least in which a component of that innovation was acquired from outside.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Try to summarize this very interesting panel. I would say that the two main blocks of creating an innovative environment or high-tech innovative environment are transparency and mobility. And transparency related to what you just described, and mobility is about people and knowledge. Allow that to happen, contribute to the regulation that will open those markets. And the other elements that was I was taking notes through the panel is Latin American people learn to work in teams. Working in teams, creating by far better capabilities in startups, in companies, in the public sector, in the private sector, and talented. If you lack of them for the meanwhile, you do have them, but if you lack of them in the meanwhile, find a way to bring them from other places. They exist around the world, and it's only a matter of capital. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you very much. Thank you, my panel members. Thank you very much.